Well, welcome to another Lightblade Learning Lab. Today, I'm going to show you how to do something impossible with this machine. That sounds a bit of a contradiction, doesn't it? Okay, if you want to get picky, it's difficult, and you have to think about it. What I'm going to do, I'm going to finish up cutting a approximately 600 circle with a machine that's got a bed cutting size of only 600 by 400. So sit back and I'm going to show you how I go about solving this problem.
Okay, now what you see here is a sign that a friend of mine has asked me to make. Now, you can see from the size of those that those letters are a reasonable size that I can cut on my machine. On the end, that bluey looking circular piece is about 600 millimetres diameter. Now, all along that bar, those letters have been cut in 10 millimetre thick acrylic, and they're bolted to the bar at the bottom. Now, I'll show you the drawings for those in a minute. It's all made in small pieces, not individual letters. And on the front of the clear acrylic letters, I've cut some white separate letters that will be covered in vinyls. Now, the crown at the top is separate and will be covered in vinyl. And I've made that bluey looking piece on the left hand side in several pieces, as I said. But if you want to cover it with vinyl, then you don't want any cracks or gaps to show. No screw fixings or anything. You need a nice flat surface. So somehow I've got to manufacture that shape in one piece. Bear in mind, we can only cut 600 by 400 on this machine. So each one of these rectangles that's on here is a 600 by 400 rectangle to try and work out how I could break the job down and make it cuttable with this machine. Now, all of these 10 millimeter perspex letters are going to be mounted on a bar, steel tubular bar, that's shown below here. And so here's how I went about cutting it from seven pieces of material. But the next challenge was to get this blue shape as one piece. The first thing I did was to copy it. The next thing I can do is I can put an enclosing rectangle around it, which just makes life easy for me because I can go like that. And then I can put a dividing line across it, across the center. So F7 is a center line on that vertical, and F7 is a center line on that vertical. And there we go. I've now divided that object into two nice equal parts, and I can remove the rectangle. Now what I'm going to do is to copy this. Like that. I should now be able to trim these two objects. We'll take the bottom off of that one and the top off of that one. And then we'll throw away the dividing line. So the plan is to put the material in the machine and cut this top half first. Then we'll turn the material round. And if I turn the material round, then what I've got to do is to turn this second part round as well. So I shall save those to a DXF file, and then we'll put them into RDWorks. Well, here they are in RDWorks, and we don't want them both at once. So we'll take one of them away and we'll just do the top half first. Now you'll note, let's just pop that onto the work area, and you can see that it's a snug fit. But you'll note where my green square is, the bottom right hand corner. Now I've done that by going to config system settings, and there it is there. I've set the datum or the head position where it's convenient for me to see it. So we save that to a U file, and we'll call that one seal one. And then we'll do Control Z to get back to the pair of them, and we delete that one. And then we'll do the same with this. We've got cut parameters up here, which I have got to set, and I've set it to 6 millimeters a second, which For a 60 watt tube is probably comfortably slow. Maybe I could go at 8 or even 9. But 6 is really comfortable. I don't want to fail on this one. Okay, and we've got it set to 78% power, which is 60 watts maximum output for this machine. Okay, let's save that one to a U file, a seal 2, and then we'll jump onto the machine.
Right, well, here we've got a piece of acrylic, as you can see. It's clearly marked Perspex. And this piece of material is 610 millimetres wide, so it's wide enough to fit neatly in the machine. What I'm going to do is cut it off at about the same sort of size, 610, 620. And I'm going to use the machine to cut it off with. So we'll cut it off at 620. Because I think what I've got to cut is around about 585. Now, there is a back plate in there that would allow me to push this right the way through. But, hey, I'm lazy. I'm not going to take that back plate out. Let's turn it round instead. And there's my cut line there. Just find out approximately where it is. About there. Yep. Then we run the head to one end. And we set the power up manually. I've got that set to 67%. I can go up to 78%. There we go. So that's maximum power. Enter. And now we'll set the speed. For 5mm acrylic, I would think probably should be able to do that at about 6mm a second. Now, it doesn't matter if it doesn't cut through completely. You'll see what I mean. Obviously, it's not going to cut all the way across because this is 610 and the machine is only 600 wide capable. So if I press the pulse button and the arrow key at the same time, so, and I better put some extraction on. There we go. So we'll see what we've got. Now, regardless of whether this is, oh, well, it's cut through. And all we're going to do is just crack the ends. So it's cut through nicely. Okay, now, I've got my steel table on here, but it doesn't have to be the steel table, it could be anything. I've raised the table up so that it is level with this border around the outside there. So it sits on there nice and flat. Now I've got the first part of my program in there, which I called Seal 1. And because it's very, very tight on the material, I need to have my datum as far across to the left as possible. And I might take it back about 5mm. There we go, just a little bit. I've got scope to play with backwards and forwards, but I've got very little scope this way. So I've got to be fairly accurate with my material and the program in the X direction. Otherwise I should get a slot error. So we're showing a slot error in Y, which basically means my program is running off the back of the table. So I've got to bring my datum a little bit further forward, my origin. Origin. Now I'll probably get a frame okay. Right, so now what I've got to do is pull my material forward to where the back part. There we go. So I can pull this forward now so that it stays just on the material, the back of the machine. Just try that again. It stays on the material down the right hand side there. It stays on the material on the left hand side and it does not run off the back. Okay, so we're ready to run the first part of the program. I'm running at 78% power and 6mm a second. Okay, that's the easy bit done. Now I'm going to load in part 2, which is seal 2, and to do this second part, I'm going to have to turn the job round, and that's why I reversed the program. So we take the job out of the machine and pop it back in. And now what we're trying to do now, we can see the end of the cut here and here. We're going to try and line the laser beam up to pick up exactly where that cut finished up, and this one. And this is where I'm going to show you a few tricks. The one thing you'll notice is I've got my red dot pointer taped up. I don't use it. I find it very, very annoying. But there are times when it might be useful. But to be honest, this is not one of those times, because I've got to have exact accuracy. And the only way I can get exact accuracy is to actually use the pulse button. The pulse button tells me exactly where the beam is going to hit. Now, we know that the head has stopped at our origin position. So the first thing we've got to do is we've got to make sure that the end of that cut lines up exactly with that nozzle. And we can do that almost by eye to start with. What I'm going to do now is to not worry about this end. I'm going to go to the other end. Do more or less the same sort of thing at this end. Now, I'm not interested in trying to find out exactly where the end of the cut is, like there. That's not what I'm trying to find. What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to find the line of the end of the cut. The origin point at the other end will decide where the program comes back and joins. All I've got to do is swing this job this way here to make sure that it sits in line with the nozzle. It's got to come back a bit. And then I'll put a pulse down. I'll get a little bit closer. And I'll put another pulse down and see how close I am to the end of the line. And I would say, looking at those two marks, they would intersect exactly with the end of my line. As I said, I'm not interested in finding the exact position. I'm interested in getting it lined up that way. So do two or three pulse dots and make sure that it lines up. Don't do it on the job, do it outside the job. I'm happy that the other end of the job lines up exactly in the right plane that way. But now I've lost my datum here. So what I should do is I shall press the frame command again. And that will drive around. And when it settles, of course, it'll settle back at my datum position, which is there. So let me just check that the pulse is in. I would say that that's right in the beam. Pull it just a shade. I would say I'm pretty well lined up. Well, if we've got it to join, it should lift off. I have to say, there's nothing more than what you would consider a normal start-finish point at either side. Well, that's a bit quieter. I did promise you a short session today, and here we are. We're at the end of this session. Hopefully this has been a very useful trick that you might be able to utilise in the future. If you like to extend this from being just a 600mm diameter circle, bear in mind the depth of this bed is 400. So technically I could extend and use a piece of material up to 800mm. I could get an 800mm by 600mm shape out of this machine using this trick. In the 800mm direction, I wouldn't guarantee it to be better than about maybe half a millimetre. But that really depends upon your ability and your eyes to set up that little start point. Well, thank you very much for your time, and I shall see you in the next session.